Hi, Coke Scholar family and friends. Welcome to The Sip, the podcast that shares a taste of how Coke Scholars around the world are igniting positive change. This season features amazing panels of scholar experts discussing interesting and timely topics. My name is Aisha Shebi, and I'm excited to lead you through this season. I'm a proud 2020 Coke Scholar originally from Miami, Florida, and now a junior at Princeton University studying medical anthropology. I also have my own podcast called The Hybrid Podcast. For those who are listening and may not be a Coca-Cola scholar, welcome. We're so glad you're here. To give you a little background, the Coca-Cola Scholars Foundation is the largest achievement-based and corporate-sponsored scholarship program in the country. Each year, it awards $20,000 to 150 high school seniors across the country who share a unique passion for service and leadership. There are now over 6,000 Coke Scholars creating positive change around the world. If you want to learn more, you can visit their website, coca-colascholarsfoundation.org. In this episode, Samuel Wakefield, Nelda Brown, and Dr. Laura Froyen will discuss navigating the ups and downs of parenthood, particularly during a pandemic, and some tips they've learned along the way. Let me tell you a little about these amazing Coke Scholar parents. Samuel Wakefield, a 2001 Coke Scholar, is father to four precocious daughters. He leads the Organizer Zero Project, an organization that believes that when parents have the tools and resources they need to advocate for educational equity, then they can lead their own liberation. He's also a published author on fatherhood, an avid educational blogger, and former elementary school teacher. Nelda Brown, a 1989 Coke Scholar, became the custodial guardian and primary caregiver for her then 3-year-old cousin Eric in 2007. She has led efforts to promote and expand curricular and co-curricular programs in our nation's K-12 schools and communities for nearly 2 decades, and currently serves as staff aide to Fairfax County School Board at-large member Karen Key Gamara. Leading this conversation is 2002 scholar Dr. Laura Froyen, who has a PhD in Human Development and Family Studies with a specialization in couple and family therapy. She's the mom to 2 children, Ellie and Evie. Laura helps families embrace more conscious and respectful parenting, forge deeper relationships, and live more purposeful and joyful lives through social media, coaching, online courses, and her chart-topping podcast, The Balanced Parent. Get ready, friends. Here are Samuel, Nelda, and Laura.
Hello, everybody. We are going to be talking about parenting with 3 Coke Scholars. I'm Dr. Laura Froyen. I'm a 2002 Coke Scholar, and I've got 2 kiddos who are 9.5 and almost 7, just a couple weeks to go there. And I'm joined by 2 other Coke Scholars, Samuel Wakefield, a 2001 Scholar, and Nelda Brown, a 1989 Scholar. Samuel, why don't you introduce yourself first, and then we'll go to Nelda.
Hey, everybody. So Samuel Wakefield, like Laura said, a 2001 scholar. My wife and I, we live here in Atlanta, Georgia, with 4 daughters. So stair step, 12, 9, 6, and 3. Always forget the last one's age. And so, yeah, we have a lot of Black girl magic in our household. And that's what we do. We make girls.
And what about you, Nelda?
So my name's Nelda. I'm a Coke Scholar 1989, the very first class, which seems like 100 years ago. I'm actually parenting a now 18-year-old. I became a parent when my cousin became his guardian at age 3. And so, I feel like I'm new to the game, but not really, and worn out all at the same time. So
I mean, yeah. We're kind of always new to the game, right? Because yeah. They're always growing and developing. And, you know, Samuel, I don't know about you, but both of my kids are so different that it's like relearning for every single one. There's things that are the same developmentally, but they're so different and unique. I feel like I'm always learning, always kind of an inexperienced parent. Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah. I mean, the game is always changing, I say, right? So what my preteens are dealing with right now, I'm so thankful for my girls who are my 6 and 3-year-old, because they're still like, they run and meet me at the door. They're like, oh, daddy's home. You know, the preteens, they're like, they're done with me at this point. So, you know, I'm like, I still have this other, we call them the bigs and the littles in our household. So I still have the littles that I'm like, okay, these little two, they're still my friends right now.
And Nelda, did you find that challenges changed over the years?
Definitely the challenges changed. And I would actually say it's interesting because I began kind of approaching this like he was like me, right? Like, and trying to approach parenting like I was parenting a smaller version of myself. And I could not, I mean, he can be more different than me in wonderful ways. And so anyway, that's one of the things I had to learn quickly. This is not you. What worked for you will not work for this one. And yeah, and I'm experiencing some of those same things that you all described, except I heard my, he just turned 18, called me that one the other day. So I have that to look forward to.
That one. I like it.
That one, yeah.
Oh my gosh. Nelda, I want to just hold to the light this wisdom that you're sharing. So there is this very common quote that goes around in parenting circles, to be the parent you needed as a child. And you just touched on this point of wisdom that I work, you know, the parents that I work with all the time need to hear, is that you actually don't need to be the parent you needed as a child. You need to be the parent that you needed as a child to your own inner child, because that little one who's still inside us all needs a little bit of support and love, but you actually have a different person on the outside. So that wisdom was such a beautiful piece. I wanted to just hold to the light for a moment.
Well, it's funny that you bring that up, because I often say I'm a person of faith. And so I often tell myself, let me be what he needs in this moment, right? Not what I want him to be, not what I probably would have appreciated, but what he needs in that particular moment. So
yeah.
Love that.
Hence the gray hair. Yeah.
That's that wisdom hair, right?
Yes, that's exactly right.
Hey, that's earned. Earned wisdom.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah. And it's beautiful. I'm starting to get these little streaks on the sides of my temples too, that my girls tell me I look like Elsa from Frozen with. And I'm okay with
that.
Not
a bad comparison.
No, I'm good. Yeah. It's good.
Elsa, we'll take that.
Yeah, we'll take it. We'll take some magic. All right. So we, our community of Coke Scholars submitted some questions for us. Do we want to dive into some of those questions?
Sure.
Okay. Sure. So let's start off with just kind of situating ourselves with where we've been for these past 2 years. I know, Samuel, you and I got to talk about parenting kind of towards the beginning of the pandemic, and now we're perhaps on our way out. And I'm kind of curious about what you've seen in your kids. You know, so you came into the pandemic with a 1.5-year-old, a 1-year-old. And what have you, like, with your 4 kids ranging big developmental stages, what have you seen and kind of the changes in them through this pandemic? What are their struggles that they're facing?
Yeah, that's a big question. I mean, I'll say that, you know, for us as a family, pre-pandemic, we probably looked like a lot of other families. You know, kids were in gymnastics and dance and activities, and, you know, I'm traveling each week for work. And I mean, you know, we had the schedule that looked like, were we all insane all the time? For no reason.
Go, right?
Right. Because, you know, someone told us that we just had to hurry all the time. And then the pandemic hit, and, you know, for our family, I mean, everything stopped. And in a lot of ways, you know, I work in education. And so one of the things that was really interesting to me, and I'm on the board of my kid's school. And so I had an opportunity to sort of watch their, you know, they were home doing their virtual learning and whatnot. And so I had an opportunity to sort of see what was going on. And, you know, I saw my oldest get completely disengaged, you know, in the whole learning process. My oldest two. And then, you know, my younger two, one who was, you know, pre-K, and then the other one who was in the pre-K, you know, they were just really struggling with this idea of virtual learning at the time. And I just remember thinking as a family, you know, we were like, none of this is working. And I think for a lot of parents probably around the country at that point, I mean, my mini soapbox in terms of just education, I think a lot of families saw education was broken to begin with already, but this was a first, like an up close and like, wow.
In their face. Yeah.
Every single day. Okay. And so we actually made a couple of big shifts. And one of the things we did was we pulled our kids out of school. So I can talk more about that, but we decided during the pandemic, you know what, you know, traditional schooling just doesn't work for our kids. And we had been leaning in that direction for a little while, but, and I'm a huge public school advocate. I work at public schools. My kids go to public schools, but schooling private, public, all of it. It just doesn't work the way we thought it should work. And so that was one of the big ahas for us, just how do we create environments where our kids can thrive and do more self-directed learning. And I think the pandemic presented an opportunity for us to try something new. And we've sustained it since, you know, we started it last year. So I think that's probably been one of the biggest shifts for us. The reality that, okay, you know, this crisis has presented an opportunity. Let's not let this opportunity go to waste. Let's figure out how to milk it and how to make some adjustments. And one of the biggest ones was, you know, we changed the way our kids spent their time learning. Cause that's half of their waking hours, you know?
It's huge. Yeah.
And, you know, if they're not doing something that everybody is all in for, I mean, why are we doing it? And so, yeah, I think for us, we saw it as an opportunity to provide our kids some opportunity to have some agency and some choice and, you know, to be determined. We're seeing how it goes right now. We're a year in, but I think some of the early signs are that they feel more empowered and engaged in what they've decided to spend their time doing.
That makes my child development
comes on the other side.
Yeah, that makes my child development heart so happy. So, are you homeschooling? Are you unschooling? Are you co-op schooling?
So it's a version of unschooling, right? So they are participating in a self-directed learning center, which is a cohort of other students. But it's, you know, there's no teachers, there's no grades or tests or anything like that. But there are guides. There are adults who help them to think about, how do I want to spend my time? How do I want to map out, whether it's an apprenticeship or map out a set of curriculum that I can pursue that allows me to accomplish some things I'm passionate about or learn some core competencies, things like that. And right now our oldest three are involved in it. And our youngest is still in a private pre-K model at a private school. So yeah, I mean, you know, we've done all of the various modes of schooling, and this is our next attempt to try what might work for them. Wow. And you know, there's no one size fits all, right? Like, I mean, these are four little people who are quick to remind me that they all have individual personalities. So we'll see whether or not it works for each of them. But so far, that's so good.
Wow, that's so. Your oldest, then, like, what would be her grade equivalent then? Like,
she would be like seventh grade. So sixth, seventh grade, fourth, fifth grade, kindergarten, first. I feel like what's the other one?
I was curious just because, like, mine when the pandemic started was in the 10th grade. And so even if we had wanted to do something like that, like, you know, at this point, like, we're pushing, you know, we're looking at the finish line and getting to college and not a lot of room for that. But it's interesting. I also leaned in a different way. It's, you know, I also, it would be remiss to, like, not acknowledge the privilege that it is to be able to sit across for your child when they're doing their virtual learning, right? Because, you know, some parents, a lot of my kids' friends, parents were still working, right? They had to go in, they had to hit the, you know, jump in the truck or hit the Amazon, you know, the warehouse line, and weren't able to see what was happening with their kids. So I just like to acknowledge that, you know, that's just to even be present to see what was going on. But yeah, it's funny. I began to see, like my kid, his, where he falls short, right? Kind of different from you. Yes, there were definitely things that our school could have done better, but I saw a lot of what my kid could do better.
So you're like, they're not the problem. You are, my kid.
Yeah, like some of it was them, but like I also saw, you know, like some little things, you know, like his grades actually jumped during the pandemic. The first, and I should say he is in a private school, but we did go virtual for that spring, but his grades like jumped up because I was able to see, oh my gosh, you're sitting here listening to this like it's, you know, the Nickelodeon channel and not a lecture. You should be taking notes, you know, that kind of thing. And so
he needed support that he wasn't necessarily getting in the classroom. That's right. That when you were there, that makes so much sense.
Well, it makes me think about like the biggest thing that I saw across the network of schools that I work with was just executive functioning skills in particular for students. It became very clear that, you know, there's a real lack of executive functioning skills. And so you put a group of kids in front of computers and say, hey, go you know, manage yourself, manage your time, manage your ability to focus and pay attention and do all of this, all the stuff that adults didn't want to be able to do, right?
Working virtually.
Right. And then we are surprised when students were having social emotional challenges with, you know, engaging with content. I mean, yeah. So I saw it as a huge opportunity to build some of that with the girls. And it sounds like you did as well with your son. And then I think it raises a whole other series of questions around, like, is that something that they should have been doing already in school? Maybe, maybe not, you know, but it was an opportunity to help build that for sure. Yeah.
Yeah, we had a similar experience, especially with my older one. So she was in first grade when the kind of the shutdown happened, and it became clear very early on that virtual schooling was not going to be a viable option for her. She is a neurodiverse kiddo who really can't handle that level of screen time and engagement. And so she was just, we basically unschooled her for that last part of that spring and just turned in pictures of her reading and writing to her teacher, which was fine with for her teacher. But what we noticed was that the kind of the daily meltdowns that she would come home with after school, she would have this kind of, it's called after school restraint collapse. She would have them a lot. Sometimes school was so stressful that she'd get physically ill too. Those stopped entirely. She was a completely different kid from an emotional perspective once she was out of a school setting, and we realized, like, wow, we didn't know how hard school was for her. As she got older, she was able to tell us a little bit more about how, if she was upset or sad during the day, how scared she was that she would get in trouble with her teacher or that her peers would make fun of her. It was just really stressful for an intensely sensitive kid. Wow. Who has some emotional, you know, regulation delays perhaps. So we went looking for other options for her for the next year, and now she's in this school where they have really wonderful restorative justice practices. They have really great, very social and emotionally aware teachers. Their primary learning objectives are to love learning and learn how to learn as opposed to memorization. Yes. And so she's just a different kid now in a different school setting. So I agree, Samuel, we took this as an opportunity to change the way we were doing things instead of just doing things because that's how you do them, really getting intentional with them. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Do you feel like as the world is opening back up and as you are kind of kids are getting back into activities? So Samuel, you were saying you were kind of overscheduled maybe with your kiddos. I don't know, Nelda, if that was the case for your son. I know we were doing a lot more. We've been feeling really reluctant to kind of get back into the level of activities that we were in before. My one daughter wants to go back to gymnastics and the other one really just wants to play all day when she gets home from school. What are you noticing with kind of the intentionality to which you're going to return to normal? Are you returning? Are you crafting a new normal for yourselves and for your families? What's going on there?
Yeah, I would say a lot of our schedule is back, but different, right? Because I think that the systems themselves are different, right? So I have a basketball player and who always dabbled in a second sport, right? So it was either tennis or track or something else and basketball. So we are no longer doing basketball 5 days a week plus games on the weekend because the practices just because of gym space and time, that just didn't happen, right? For the first year after the shutdown. And I would say his senior year this year, we were kind of maybe back to that a little bit more, like the seasons were full again. But by that time, I would say that he needed that. And, you know, he needed the social interaction. I think I also, you know, I have a gamer, and so he was happy to stay at home. Like he was glad when things shut down. His life pretty much didn't change, you know, except for the going to practices. So yeah, I'm somewhat mindful of those things. So there's certain things, but we're in Northern Virginia, and there's actually still a lot of things are still virtual, and so there's still a lot of COVID caution around in our community. So things haven't completely returned yet. But I also have a 12th grader, which I know it's different than you all. And so like he's preparing to go off and colleges are up and running and, you know, and so I'm going back to normal, I guess what we used to call normal. So kind of getting him trying to get him aware and developing habits to kind of keep himself safe and be cautious. But, you know, hey, good luck with that. Like I said, he's different than me.
I love that. Good luck with that. Yeah. Yeah, we, I mean, I think similarly, we've said, you know what, we don't want to go back to normal. And I think we've taken some concrete steps. I mean, first of all, we've always had a bit of a, we've sort of been a bit hamstringed in this situation because we have too many kids to everybody do too many activities. So we've always had a sort of a, listen, you know, you're gonna do one or two different things because we can't follow y'all. And, you know, we have a network, we have a village. We can't, I mean, I'm blessed that like my mother-in-law, my sister, like we have family who lives around us almost within walking distance. So, you know, the village is always there for various different activities and things. And still, you know, like, you know, I think we've always tried to find some ways to minimize, but I will say, I mean, we're back to some things like, you know, attending church in person and that kind of deal. The girls are not really involved in a lot of extracurricular activities right now. And I love that. They love that. I mean, we go biking in the afternoons or, you know, we'll go on trips. You know, I don't travel as much as I used to. Yeah. I think all of those things help. I think, I do think that as my oldest two in particular continue to get older, I mean, they're, you know, I think we're sort of bracing ourselves for the next wave of, you know, all right, what are the next set of activities that you will likely want to opt into? But I think right now, you know, they're not saying anything. We're not saying anything. So we're just going to enjoy this lull of some good downtime and continuing to make, you know, we have dinner every day that I'm here in town, which is most days now. So, I'm like, this is okay. We can keep this going for a little while. We're going to see how long it lasts.
Can I ask a question? Because it's a little different from my end. Because because when the pandemic started, Eric was in the 10th grade, getting college bound. And so it was stressful for all of us that there weren't activities, right? Because he's then having to look at college applications and having to explain, well, why is it that you've only done 20 hours of service? It's a pandemic, you know, or whatever, you know, yeah. That kind of thing in activity. And so anyway, it's kind of interesting. I wonder if you would see it differently if your kids were a little bit older, because it was a gift for you in a way. And yes, the schedule was definitely like still a gift for me, loving Zoom still. It did cause some kind of, you know, like I said, and it's socially too. I don't know if it's okay to transition to this, but socially as a teenager, there is my parenting heart was kind of divided in half. I could shelter, not only keep him sheltered in place, but shelter him, right? From things just a little bit longer because the world kind of shut down as we know it. But at the same time, this is now an 18-year-old boy that hasn't been able to have some kind of the traditional kind of rite of passage experiences. And now is, you know, kind of expected to go into the world and be a man and hasn't, you know, like they didn't have parties for 2 years, you know, or whatever. So it's funny, we were having conversations about kind of getting him ready for college and just kind of, he's like thinking, well, I never been to a dance party. We never had them because he started the pandemic in high school and his things shut down. And, you know, so it's just kind of interesting in a weird way. I'm eager for things to kind of, I won't say it's going to ever be normal, but to kind of open up more. Because I want my child to have these experiences when he's with me, right? As opposed to kind of experiencing some things for the first time. But you guys have the luxury that your littles are littles. Even your bigs are littles.
Even the bigs are littles. This is true. This is true. I wonder what it would look like if they were, if they were older. Yeah, because I mean, I think the challenges that you're raising, I mean, those are such important
points.
Yeah. And I have a number of friends whose kids were graduating during the pandemic. You know, they were supposed to be having their senior seminal moments, but then those things didn't occur. You know, they had to not have a formal graduation or, you know, not have that senior prom. And I mean, that's a wild thing to imagine, not having those types of moments the way we had it. Though I wonder too if they're gonna look back. I mean, they don't know it any different based on what this is their experience. That's, you know, right. this yeah. is
Yeah, I was devastated that Eric didn't have a homecoming dance, right? Like that, but he was like, homecoming, whatever, you know. But the things that really got him are driving. He learned how to drive in the pandemic. And again, we live in Northern Virginia, DC, the DMV, DC metro area. And so to learn how to drive with no traffic is one thing. And then to when the cars come back, that's something completely different. So like, those are the things I'm more concerned about. Some of the skills.
He was like, Mama, you didn't prepare me for this. What is this?
Pulling all up on cars because I'm used to driving fast, you know?
So, yeah. And that's one of the things that is kind of our job as parents, right? To prepare them with the skills that they need to go out and be successful as adults. Yeah. And you were hampered by these past 2 years really got in the way of being able to do that for him. Yeah. Oh, that's hard.
He'll jump into the deep end, though, I'm sure.
Well, that is that's the other thing too, is that they are good, they are good at figuring things out and making a way, and he's also not alone in this, so there's this whole generation of kids who were 16 when this went in. He will have that shared kind of cohort experience too. He'll go to college with a bunch of other people who haven't been to parties before, or been to just very few. They can all be awkward together. And, I just want to reassure you too that there were lots of people. I was one of them who went to college never having been to a party before, even when there wasn't a pandemic, because some of us are nerdy and awkward just all on our own without pandemics getting in the way. So he'll find his people for sure. Okay, so one of the questions that one of our Koch scholars asked us was about cell phone usage in kiddos. When is the appropriate age to give a child a cell phone, and what are some tips for keeping kids off the internet and social media? And I just want to bow to the folks who have older kids who are maybe in this age range. My kids are only 9 and 7. We just got them a smart Gizmo watch so that they can go to the park by themselves. So that's the closest to technology that we've really gotten. We stay super close to them if they are ever looking at YouTube videos. We're sitting right next to them. And no, normally they don't play games by themselves just because, they're little, they're not into it yet. So those of you who are old, have older kids, what are we thinking about? The age for which you're thinking about a cell phone for your kiddos.
Do you want to go first, Samuel?
Sorry, I was talking to one of my coworkers in the background.
That's okay.
I
Do you
call
want me
these
to
people my
jump in?
coworkers. Yes, feel free
Yes.
to jump
Okay.
in.
So yeah. So I'll tell you what we did and what I did, and I'm not sure I'd recommend it to anybody, but I think Eric got his first real cell phone around 7th grade, because what I noticed was that that cell phone was my cell phone. It was like when he started doing activities where he was kind of moving places or staying after school, like I needed that. I felt like I needed that to track him, right? And honestly, I don't think he really the phone didn't really become a phone to him until maybe 8th or 9th grade, when you start having kind of the, and again, he's a socially awkward boy, he'd hate me for saying that, but like he wasn't on the phone and doing those types of things. It was, if he wasn't talking to me, he was like using it to try to get on games, right? On his cell phone, which I figured we had like a PlayStation or whatever here. He didn't need to use his phone for that. And so I blocked a lot of those things. And so I would say 7th grade, or whenever the child became more kind of like physically mobile, to
And
kind
you
of
needed to
just,
be able to get in touch with him.
absolutely,
Yeah.
absolutely.
But still had it kind of locked down so that you could kind of customize his experience.
I have it locked down now too, and he's 18. And I figure as long as I'm paying for it. So, he
That's
said
right.
something the other day to me about, well, you don't need my phone. I was like, too bad you don't have a phone. You're using my phone.
That's right. I like that. Yes. I mean, we're on the beginning end of that. So, my oldest two, but in particular, my oldest has been asking for the last year or so pretty earnestly, hey, when can I get a phone? And a lot of her friends in middle school age are starting to get phones. I've said this several times, and I try to not say things out loud as a parent, like to my, I try not to make declarations, like statements of declarations, like this will not happen, because I always get called on it and it never works. So, but I've said this out my face mouth several times over the years. No child of mine is going to have a phone unless you have a job. Because I purchased a phone when I started working in high school in the 90s. It's, you know, you don't need a phone unless you have a job. Now, I know it's times are different, blah, blah, blah. It is, I'm still pretty committed though to that reality, to be honest. I'm also pretty committed to my girls working. So that's a whole other conversation. Like they will work a job, period. No, your job is not like to get good grades. That's a given. Your job is to have a job. So you will have a job of some sort, because you're going to learn some of the things that come with working a job. But, you know, my wife is not really interested in that. She's like, we will likely get them phones because we will, all of the things that sensible people like yourself have just named and mentioned, like, you know, that'll likely happen. I assume it's going to happen in the next year or so for the oldest, to be honest. I won't tell her that, but, you know.
Hope she's not watching her friend's phone.
Right, and hopefully she's not watching or listening. But yeah, I mean, and then we'll do, I mean, right now they have an iPad that, you know, we have all of the controls and the, you know, all of that stuff for, and, you know, it's limited. I mean, right now we also have this thing where we keep all of our phones anyways, my wife and I, like we keep our phones in our office so that we can basically, so that once we do sort of go over the threshold with phones for them, so that they know, like all phones go in the office, that's where your phone goes too at nighttime. Right. So we'll figure out different things, but
yeah, Samuel, we have something similar.
We haven't figured that out.
We have something similar. We keep all of our phones and devices in one drawer in the kitchen that just to create a culture of this is where phones go. Mom and dad's phones go there at night. They go there during dinner. They go there, you know, at set periods of time for sure.
I've tried to do that too. And honestly, I've had like a little bit of success, not a lot of success. It's often a point of like struggle in our household because the phone, you know, on the charger at 11, it used to be like 10:30, you know, kind of the backing up time. And I hear my kids say it, I am the only parent ever that makes their child plug their phone up in a central location. But it's, if you, you know, to answer the part of the question that you said about kind of how do you kind of manage control, that's part of it. It's learning how to turn it off. Right. Because if left to his own devices, my kid would be on his phone. Now he has figured out they FaceTime, they do all sorts of things like on other apps, you know, kind of talking to different friends, and they would do it all night long if left unchecked. And so that is a big thing. And also kind of, I'm kind of old school. I grew up in Oklahoma, family from the South. My kid has like ingrained in him that anytime like I'm looking at his phone, or that I will monitor what's being said on text, photos. And so in a weird way, like I think he thinks I monitor it actually more than I really do now. But
I like it.
Yeah, but like when he was younger, because like you see on this text transit, his friends are saying, oh, you know, can't send that to Eric because Anelda's going to read it. I'm like, you doggone right, you know? So
I love it.
So like just that accountability that your kid knows that somebody is, you know, it's not an unchecked like universe for them.
And then you're wanting to keep them safe, right? It's coming from a place of wanting to keep them safe.
They don't know to see that, Laura. You know that, right?
I know that. I do know that. Yes, I do. I for sure do.
I had a crash course in that with now 5 years ago. But so before we had the second set of littles, we had our oldest two at the time who were, I don't know, 7 and 9 or something like that. And we adopted and took in, became the guardians of one of my nieces. She was 15 at the time. So we helped raise her through the end of high school. And so I remember, like, I've had a snapshot of this phase with a high school girl raising her towards
the end. Are you having flashbacks?
The battles. Oh, yes. Flashbacks. The battles we had. Now, mind you, we inherited a lot of the issues because she came to us with other issues and we had this, you know, we didn't lay the groundwork, but the battles we had over phones and all kinds, social media and everything. I mean, it did, it helped us to really think about, okay, for these other folks coming along, what do we need to do to put this in place so that we don't have some of those same battles? One of those things was, you know, we're going to delay as long as we can the whole phone, introducing phone social media to them. So,
their brains aren't necessarily ready for it quite young. You know, they I don't know if you've seen this documentary on social media that Netflix did, I think, a couple years ago now. These apps and programs are specifically designed to target our brains and using psychology in a way to make them more as addictive as possible. Just like the scroll down feature on Instagram, you know, when you scroll with your thumb and it kind of like reloads, do you know what I'm talking about? They base that off of the pull down on Instagram. They base that off of slot machines because to access the same addictive, like, you know, lottery, you know, gambling, addictive parts of our brain. Most of those developers don't let their kids have social media accounts until they're at least 15 or 16. They try to keep, you know, those things as old as possible so that their brains can develop. Because otherwise they don't have the executive functioning to really control it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, we did the same thing. I was asked my kid. He was the last to get everything because of that, because I just knew it socially wasn't mature enough to kind of handle those. And it's hard to get it back, right? Like, you know, again, I know you guys aren't thinking about college necessarily yet, but like, you know, your kids, you put something out there and it's out there. You know, even if you can take it down, it can be screenshot and shared and then sent to the wrong person. And so, it's just a battle. Cause like I had a lot of in our house didn't allow it. And yet he still kind of found ways to do different things before. And so, again, I would just encourage anybody to have open conversations with your children about why, right? It's not necessary that you're trying to control them or just because I said so, at least that never worked with my kid, but just really trying to understand the safety and the big picture of things. And it will be there. It will be there. Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, I wanted to circle in, Nelda, and Samuel, I didn't realize you had this experience too. I know that you adopted your son from foster care when he was quite young. And Samuel, you had this experience of having a child that you kind of saw through to the end of her teen years. How has that been for you, kind of bringing in a child, and how did that process go?
So actually, I should clarify. So he was actually in foster by my aunt, who was his foster mother, who had some health issues. She was much older. He had the energy of like an Energizer bunny at age 3. Okay. And it soon became clear that she didn't have the energy to kind of keep up with him. And so then he came with me. One of the things I would say to anybody who's out there is that there's never going to be a perfect moment, right? I think that I was always thinking, I wanted to have a bigger house, or I wanted to have, you know, more space, or this or that. But it's like when the time comes, you open yourself up to it, and it's just, there's no perfection needed, really. And so it's been the best decision, and probably the biggest job I've ever, like the most important job. I always tell him, you know, I have a career, I went to school to study things and do things, but you are the thing that is the, like, you know, that will be what my life's work, you know, that's, and he's like, don't say that. I'm like, it's true though.
Love that. Yeah. I love that. That's a proud mama right there.
Yeah. Something like that. We'll see.
you all can't see me, but I'm crying over here.
Yeah. Well, to do it alone, I think, is a little different again, because I think that, and I'm sure Samuel, you probably had this experience too, is that, for me, when you see a child in need, and especially for me, it was within my family, you know, other things kind of fall to the side a bit. You know, I was on a career track and made choices. I think you did too, about just kind of what you're going to do with your job, because you want to make sure that you're there and present. And, you know, I was working probably 70, you know, 60 hours on a good week before then. Working on Saturdays was nothing, you know, like, and you can't do that if you're, well, I'm sure you can, but like, it was hard to do that with a child, you know? So I made some career changes because of that, you know? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, everything that you've said, whether it's the, you know, when you see the need and you make room, you know, in your family, you make room in your home, you make room in your life. I mean, I think that's that's what it boiled down to for us in our household. And, you know, our running joke is we've taken in a lot of strays over the years. And at any given point in time, there's at least six or seven people here. Plus the people who, like, those are the people who we birth and they live in our household. Plus, you know, mother-in-law, sister-in-law. So at any point in time, there's at least 9 or 10 people in our house on a given day, potentially. And so, you know, they're a big part of sort of what we have tried to do is create spaces where it's like, okay, this could be a space for our family, and it could be a welcoming environment. It could be a place of refuge. And that has meant that, you know, at times, I mean, you know, this particular niece was the longest sort of more formal commitment that we've made, but we've had other nieces who've also lived with us for periods of time. And, you know, I do think, it's hard because, you know, I think in some ways you are fortunate that you, a younger 3-year-old, that you at least the foundation, you got to help mold a lot of that. Awesome. Right. Yeah. I mean, we had a tremendous amount of struggles with a 15-year-old who had already really had a clear worldview and that kind of deal. But I think it taught us so much. I mean, there was a book that I was reading at the time when she came to live with us, 2017, called Move Toward the Mess. And, you know, it was, you know, for us, it was all about like this idea of like, you know, what you got it off, what is all of this for anyways? You know, you have resources, you have opportunities, you have, you know, privileges and advantages, you know, and in our family, like my wife and I are both fortunate that we have been able to get into a position to be able to, you know, serve and help and do things like that, because that was not, you know, I tell our kids all the time, y'all are growing up in a dramatically different way than your mother and I grew up. You know, she grew up in East Baltimore, city poor. You know, I grew up in the country poor. Like we were both first in families for college, different, you know, we had our own version of experiences. And so we've been able to afford a whole different level of things for our kids. And I do think a big part of this experience for us has just been, you know, opening ourselves up to like what's come as we've gone through the process. So I loved hearing your description though about like, you know, just being open and making room for the things, new things in life.
That's exactly right. Cause it was like supposed to be started off as like a 3-week visit for summer. And it's been, you know, it's like 14 years
later. A 3-hour tour.
Exactly. Having our Gilligan moment. But I think kind of even the biggest surprise to me, and I worked in youth and family, like youth and children, excuse me, not family, youth and education policy before them. But I feel like when I look at stack up my work, you know, compared to like what I've done with my cousin and with all of the people and friends and things that we've come in contact because of him, right? It's been a gift. I look at, you know, we're putting together all these senior collages, you know, you'll get there like in the 12th grade pictures, and you look at this and you realize it wasn't just your child, right? It wasn't just my cousin. It's his, the best friends, the basketball teammates, the this, the that, you know, and that you get to really make a difference or participate in the life of a child. And that has been a gift that he will probably never fully understand, because we've been able to kind of participate and do things I don't think I probably would have done if I was at work all the time, you know. So yeah.
I love that, Nelda. Thank
That's
you.
Why I'm so tired though.
this idea of making room, I feel like that's something that as parents we all have to do. We have to make room for the hopes and the dreams and expectations that we had. And we have to make room for the reality of the kids that we got. Yes. Make room for their hopes and dreams, which might be quite different than ours, right? Mm-hmm. That's a big task, that making room piece. It's a big part of parenting, at least for me, it is. Yeah. All right. So Samuel and Nelda, one of the things that we do here at the SIP podcast is the Fast Five towards the end, where I ask, where the person who's kind of moderating asks the guests some quick, fast answer questions that you're supposed to answer kind of on the fly, fast, without thinking about it. Are we ready for this?
I think so.
Right.
Okay. All right. So the first one is, and you guys, let's have Nelda, you go first on this one. Okay. And then Samuel. What are two apps or websites that you cannot live without?
Facebook and Google Docs. That's it.
Okay. Yeah. What about you, Samuel?
Ooh, two apps. Probably Mint. I use mint.com a lot. It's like a budgeting finance thing. And probably sleep tracker right now.
Ooh, nice. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Let's see. Mine are Spotify because I like music to listen to music, and then the probably Instagram. Most of my work is on Instagram, so work has to happen there. Okay, so next question, Samuel, you're up first. If I looked at the music on your iPhone or iPod right now, what would most surprise me?
Most surprise you? I don't know if it'd be surprising, but I have a ton of Disney on my playlist. So I don't know if it'd be surprising given my kids and whatnot, but low key, Encanto is just a really good soundtrack. I don't know who's not liking that soundtrack. So,
That's also what I was gonna
you
say. The number of times we don't talk about Bruno has been played. Yes,
know.
yeah, that's mine too. Okay, Nelda, what about you?
That's funny. Well, in the spirit of Encanto and Lin-Manuel, who I believe is like the genius of our times, it's like the number of times that the Hamilton soundtrack has been played consistently on my iPhone. It's embarrassing. It truly is.
Love it.
He is
Love it.
amazing, though. He gave us Encanto, he gave us Moana, Hamilton,
Yeah.
so much in the height. Yeah. Ooh, gosh. So good. Chills. Okay, so Nelda, you're up next. Favorite book or piece of music or art that has helped or inspired you in your life?
Honestly, the first thing that came to mind, and I'll just say it, is Green Eggs and Ham. Can I explain it, right? I'm just supposed to say it. So Green Eggs
Yeah,
and
just say it. Go for it. Yeah. What about you, Samuel?
I'm just going to use the book that I'm reading right now, which is Black Joy, by Tracy Michael Lewis Gigetz. I never know how to pronounce her last name, but that's giving me life right now.
Oh, love that. Mine is a book of poetry that I'm reading right now by Young Pueblo. Young is spelled with out an O, so Yung. And he has this great book, gosh, and that I'm now like, I think it's Connection and Clarity is the name of it, that is just gorgeous writing about relationships. So if you're looking for a book of poetry about relationships, it's beautiful. All right, Samuel, what is a quote or motto do you live your life by?
Oh, a quote or motto that I live my life by. Urgent things shout, important things whisper. Listen to the whispers. It's on my Google, it's like on my away message. It's like everyone who knows me professionally, at least for sure, hears me talk about this, urgency, important things all the time. And I'm like, nah, most of the things that are urgent are just things that used to be important and now you don't need to focus on them because you got to focus on the important things. So urgent things shout, important things whisper, listen to the whispers.
Oh, whew, I feel like I got chills with that one. Thank you for that.
So
Nelda, what about you?
yeah, mine again, I'm known for like it's not as profound as yours, but Master Yoda, do or do not, there is no try,
Yeah.
has been my motto
Is
since I was
no
a kid.
try.
Yes, that's right. Do or not, there is no try. So
Love it.
love it. Mine is a quote by a respectful parenting person from a long time ago. She's long gone now, but she said, "Begin as you mean to go on." And I just feel like it's just starting out, with parenting, with the things that you're doing, with the energy that you mean to end with, really just, yeah, begin as you mean to go on. That's something that I bring to my. Okay. All right. And so our last question is, what makes the Koch Scholar Program or network unique?
I consider this as the first scholar, and again, worked in education. Sorry, this is a long answer. Sorry.
It's okay. Do it.
I've graduated from high school 100 years ago, and I'm still connected to this network of scholars. And I know no other program that does it like the Koch Scholar Network does. It's not just giving you a check. Well, the check is nice. Don't get me wrong. But the sense of community and connectedness that the foundation fosters is just a step above all else. So, yeah.
I mean, I ditto everything you just said. I mean, what's been unique for me as well is because I've been in Atlanta the last 2+ decades. You know, I've had a personal connection to the Scholars Foundation and the scholars, you know, the people who run that foundation. So, I mean, key moments. I worked at the Scholars Foundation throughout college because I lived in Atlanta and went to school here. The day that I proposed to my wife, like, I was talking to the people at the foundation. And I showed them the ring. I mean, like, there's a connection. They know all my kids have been there over the years, multiple times. Like, there's just a connection to Koch that my family has that's woven through my story from a teenage years to now. And so, yeah, I don't have any kind of connection like that to another entity.
So when I first met my cousin, when he first fostered, I was actually in Atlanta for a Koch event. So it's kind of weird that I actually met my child.
There you go. Yes.
I love that. That's so good. And, you know, I feel like it's been for me, it's been like that, like a really good friend from your past that no matter like how long you've been apart from, that you can always just like pick right back up with too. There's some nice like consistency and security. Like there, like the network is just always there, right? Like right there when you have a space and time in your life where you can come back to it, there's a space for you to be involved, which is really nice. We don't always have that kind of security in the world. Whew, okay, we did it. Thank you so much. Does everybody want to just take a second, you know, if there's places that you want to would like to connect with other Koch scholars, to like drop kind of a social or a way to get in touch, if you want to, if the people who are listening are like, oh, I really liked her, I want to reach out and talk to Nelda about something, or same for Samuel, do you want to just drop a little bit of some, I know that we'll have some links in the show notes, but sometimes it's nice for listeners to hear it out loud.
Oh, Samuel, better go first because my kid is not here to tell me like what mine are. So I have to
like wait, what is my at?
I know. Exactly. How do you say that? Like, because he's my tech. Your teenagers become your in-house tech. So.
I believe that. I believe that.
Okay, so for Nelda, see the show.
As I say, they also become the people who tell you, especially if it's a teenage girl, like, what you wearing? That's no good.
It's not okay.
I lived through that and I was like, I don't want any more of that. How do I make sure that doesn't happen again? So she did up my style. So I don't know. Maybe that was a good thing. So at S Wakefield 3, you can follow me on Twitter. That's really the only social media that I'm really on. I'm on Instagram, but not really. And I'm on Face Smash or Facebook or Instabook or whatever is it, but not really either. But probably everydayfatherhood.com is where most people can follow me, because that's like where I blog a lot about my fatherhood experiences. So if you're looking for something, you know, an interesting perspective from a dad, it's a good place to go.
Sam, we should have you on my podcast sometime. I think that would be so cool. So I have a podcast called The Balanced Parent. If folks are looking for a parenting podcast, we talk about everything from parenting, you know, especially spirited, challenging kiddos. And, you know, I have my PhD in marriage and family therapy. So we talk about relationships and, you know, all that good stuff. And then I also am on Instagram. You will find me doing silly reels and making fun of myself with dances because I'm still nerdy and awkward. But luckily I can do that and make money doing it.
I am on Instagram, but mainly only really to follow my kid. My handle there is @cousinNelda I guess, like one word, Cousin Nelda, that's what Eric calls me. And on Facebook, not a helpful blog or a podcast like yours, Laura, but a place where I vent mostly about being my parenting journey on Facebook.
Love it.
So that's the only reason I started a Facebook page, so that I could vent about my kid.
I mean, the like collective venting and being real and raw with each other is so helpful, I think, as parents. All right. Well, thank you so much, everybody. That was so great. I think that's it.
We hope you enjoyed the third episode of season 3 of The Sip, featuring Samuel Wakefield, Nelda Brown, and Dr. Laura Froyen. To read their full bios or to learn more about the tools and resources they discussed, check out our show notes or visit coca-colascholarsfoundation.org. And if you have an extra minute, we would love for you to rate the podcast, leave us a review, and subscribe so you'll be the first to receive new episodes. Tune in a couple of weeks for episode 4, where 4 Coke Scholars will discuss the important topic of mental health. Until then, see you next time on The Sip. Bye now.